This week on a special Final Four edition of One Devotion. See how much basketball lovers in Berlin enjoyed the run-up to this season's crowning moment. Check out the future stars who competed for their own continental title in the German capital. Relive an overtime thriller that will go down as one of the most dramatic title games ever. And hear from the new camps during an exclusive post-final encounter with their newest friend. The festive run-up to the Turkish Airlines Euroleague Final Four in Berlin gave way to the first basketballs bounced in anger on Friday evening, as all the qualifiers arrived to do-or-die semi-finals with dreams of glory still dancing in their heads.
Concentrate and stay together. I think this will be the key. And if we stay together, everything will be.
We have no pressure. We're just trying to come here to have fun and play good basketball.
We're just coming here ready to play. I think we haven't really paid attention to it all year. And we've just played the way we played and we've won. So we're just going to continue to do that.
It's a Final Four. It's two games and everything is open.
That everything was open was proven in two tense showdowns that were topped off by the first semi-finals overtime in six seasons. In the early historic all-Russian semi-final, CSKA Moscow used its experience of 13 Final Fours in 14 years to quickly build double-digit margins against newcomer Lokomotiv Kuban Krasnodar, thanks to Nando De Colo's 10 first-quarter points. Dante Draper and Malcolm Delaney rallied Lokomotiv, but five second-quarter triples kept CSKA up 47-37 at half-time. Lokomotiv would drop the difference to single digits, but even Draper's half-court triple and Anthony Randall's final four record of 8 offensive rebounds could not stop CSKA from running away as De Colo finished with 30 points, the most in a do-or-die Final Four game this century.
We knew it from the beginning, if we were going to play good defense, that we will have a bigger chance to win, and we play one great team defense, and that was for sure one of the biggest reasons that we won tonight.
In the second game, Fenerbahce Istanbul and Laboral Kucha Vitoria Gasteiz played an instant classic that went to overtime. Fenerbahce opened the game with 13 straight points, but that lead quickly melted as Ioannis Borossis and Darius Adams got Laboral within 41-40 at the break. The lead traded hands five times before a three-point bank shot by Borossis ended the third quarter. And a basket by Mike James opened a seven-point Laboral lead. Jan Vesely almost single-handedly brought Fenerbahce back, however. And Kostas Lukas hit the layup that sent the game into overtime. Bogdan Bogdanovic took over by scoring 9 of his team-high 18 points in the extra session as Fenerbahce grabbed the lead and never looked back, setting up a championship game date with CSKA.
I didn't lose faith all game, even when we were down with 5 minutes. We'd done it before. You know, we weren't down by 20 or something, so you know, we had our chance. I mean, we had a crowd as well, like a home game. So. Just kept fighting, man. That's what you gotta do in life, period. You gotta keep fighting until it's over.
While the game action at Mercedes-Benz Arena was the centerpiece of Final Four weekend, Berlin also hosted an ongoing basketball celebration all weekend long for anyone fortunate enough to be in the German capital. Friday morning featured the official opening of the Turkish Airlines Euroleague Fan Zone at Alexanderplatz, where fans by the hundreds of thousands enjoyed non-stop, fun-filled activities over the next 3 days. The first major event there was a one-team session and legends game, with seven Final Four ambassadors and students from the Gesumbrunnen Grundschule Elementary School in Berlin.
This is a wonderful event, and the session today has surely an exclamation point on the, let's say, social differences and, you know, bringing opportunities to let's say, disfortunate kids or kids coming from, let's say, a more difficult backgrounds and so on and so on. So I think the one thing message here is clear, that everybody's got a chance, can get ahead of life, you know, and be off to a good beginning.
I think for kids that's a very exciting moment. If I were a player, a kid, you know, and to meet the stars, ex-players, for me it would be amazing and unforgettable moment, you know. So I think it's the same for kids.
It's a great satisfaction. It's better than winning the trophies, because you know that you help them, you give them experience for life, and give them that push, because most of them, they have a very, very tough life.
Afterwards, fans were invited on court to meet and greet the legends, just as many more were able to do on Saturday, with visits by two players from each of the Final Four teams. Other major attractions during the first 2 days of the Fan Zone were appearances by the same entertainment acts who were on worldwide television during the timeouts, halftime, and quarter breaks at the Final Four games. The FS Euroleague cheerleaders put on several shows, interacted with fans, and stopped everyone at Alexanderplatz in their tracks when they started to dance. The same could be said for the Dunkin' Devils, who teamed up with Freestyle Air for a high-flying, jaw-dropping performance. With drummers, DJs, celebrities, and athletes taking their turns at the Fan Zone, the entertainment never ceased, and the spectators themselves were participants too. The Adidas 3-against-3 tournaments brought out hundreds of aspiring athletes, while passers-by were able to play games themselves, visit the myriad sponsor booths, and win prizes. For one of the newest and most popular attractions, the Instagram Mosaic Activation, more than 5,000 fans shared images with the hashtag F4Glory that reached over 6 million people worldwide, who saw 40 million plus Final Four photos. Another Saturday highlight at the Fan Zone was the insider panel discussion at the Turkish Airlines Pavilion with Final Four ambassadors Joar Laukas, Patrick Femeling, and Ibrahim Kutluay. The three former EuroLeague champions talked about the weekend's matchups, but also the trends that point towards great EuroLeague seasons ahead.
Most important thing about this for EuroLeague, seeing teams like Lokomotiv, Fenerbahce in only their second year in the Final Four, is so important for what the EuroLeague is all about. It's about parity. It's about every team has a chance to compete.
That the professionality also grows, and the coach is getting better. I mean, also building a team and maintaining a team full of superstars who get paid pretty well is not easy. I think the team aspect is so important, and most of the time is the best team is going further if the talent is equal.
So I believe next year will be more competitive, because 16 great teams will be in the league. So EuroLeague is getting bigger and bigger every year.
Last but not least, some of the Final Four ambassadors served as judges for the Turkish Airlines Slam Dunk Contest, which featured players from the Adidas Next Generation Tournament Finals and was eventually won by Sekou Doumbouya of the under-18s INSEP Paris. It was the perfect punctuation for almost a million fans who packed Alexanderplatz all weekend and enjoyed a slam dunk great time at the Turkish Airlines EuroLeague Fan Zone. The best weekend in world basketball also featured Europe's finest young talent gathering in Berlin to participate in the finals of the 14th annual edition of the Adidas Next Generation Tournament. eight teams were battling for the right to be named Europe's under 18 champions. After qualifying tournaments held across the continent over the preceding months, in Berlin, the eight teams first split into groups of four and for 3 days went head to head in a round robin games at Berlin Sports Forum. Group A was decided convincingly by FC Barcelona Lassa, which won its three games against Inset Paris, Mega BMAX Belgrade and Žalgiris Kaunas. Runners-up Inset got consistent scoring from Baptiste Chouaf during two victories, while impressive individual displays came also from Gytis Mazulis and Arnas Valička of Žalgiris and Mega's backcourt star Novak Music. Group B started with a shock as back-to-back finalist Crvena Zvezda Telekom Belgrade lost to a Lietuvos Rytas Vilnius team led by Grantas Vasiliauskas. But Zvezda bounced back, winning its other two group games, including a last-chance victory against defending champion and previously unbeaten Real Madrid, which got an excellent performance from Dino Radonjić. And when the group phase concluded with the outstanding Ferdinand Žilka inspiring host Alba Berlin to victory over Lietuvos Rytas, it was enough to allow Zvezda to top the group. Sunday's grand final between the two group winners Barcelona and Zvezda was staged at the Mercedes-Benz Arena as a curtain raiser to the Euroleague finale in the same arena later in the day. Barcelona raced into a big early lead thanks to a display of smooth shooting from Eric Villa and powerful inside dominance from big man Atuman Diagne. The Spanish team led by 16 at the end of the first quarter, but Ivan Korovic and Alexa Oskokovic stepped off the bench to spark a remarkable Zvezda fight back, and a high-scoring and entertaining first half finished with Barcelona ahead by four. The lead fell to 2 points in the third quarter as free-scoring duo Alexa Radanov and Matija Radovic kept the Serbian team in close contention, while Barcelona leaned on the scoring skills of Sergi Martinez to stay in front. In the final quarter, Barcelona further extended its advantage thanks to a flurry of points from forward Rodion Skuruks. And although Boris Simanić hit some late shots for Zvezda, the Spanish team had done enough to secure a 90-82 victory. The trophy was presented to the winning team captain Pol Figueres by Euroleague basketball president and CEO Jordi Bertomeu, allowing Barcelona to celebrate its first title in the Adidas Next Generation tournament, which has now been won by seven different teams in the last 7 years. Zvezda Simanić was named the tournament MVP, and he was joined in the all-tournament team by Kuruks and Diagne of Champions Barcelona, Alba Žilka and Velička of Žalgiris. Congratulations to all the participants in this year's Adidas Next Generation tournament. Sunday's Turkish Airlines EuroLeague Championship game promised unique thrills and emotions as soon as the two teams with the best records all season survived the semi-finals, and their head coaches knew that for the first time in their long and close friendship, they would fight each other for the EuroLeague trophy. Željko Obradović and his former assistant coach Dimitris Itoudis had won the EuroLeague 5 times in more than a decade together at Panathinaikos, but now they would be on opposite benches, trying to beat each other in the last game of the EuroLeague season.
After 13 years that we spent together, now thinking about this, that he's an opponent bench in this final game of EuroLeague is really very strange, but for another side, very special.
After the hugs and after the good luck for the beginning of the game, when the ball goes in the air, each of us will try to help his own team to win the title.
As for the players, whether they were first-time finalists or former champions, their common message was one of the utmost desire to lift the trophy.
I'm fighting to chase playing a final, and I want it more than ever.
Play with a lot of heart. Leave all the emotions on the side and just fight. You know, it's going to be pure war, and I think we're ready.
From the moment that Karl Heinz and Jan Vesely jumped center for the opening tip-off, the championship game proved totally worthy of its name. Quarter, Šeška unleashed the beautiful basketball that made it one of the top scoring teams in Euroleague history. Backcourt superstars Nando De Colo and Milos Teodosic took center stage.
Selfish basketball right there.
Suddenly, Šeška owned what seemed like an insurmountable 30-50 margin at halftime.
We're going to be very stupid if we think that the game is over. We know that we have against us a great opponent and a great coach that is going to go on them, so they're going to pressure.
We play very, very defense. We are absolutely out of concentration. They score many, many easy points. We will play with more character and more smart.
It wasn't until early in the fourth when Epe Udo stepped up with a pair of dunks and an assist to Pero Antic that the Fenerbahce faithful got back on their feet.
We have a six-point ball game. He's going against De Colo. He takes it in.
Fenerbahce found a late-game hero in Bobby Dixon, who scored a running one-hander in a crowd, made it 78-79, and plunged Šeška back into trouble. Heartbreak seemed in the cards for Šeška Moscow with just 20.8 seconds to go as Kostas Lukas went to the free throw line with a chance to give Fenerbahce its first lead since the second quarter.
It's absolutely amazing what we're seeing here. It's up to this foul sign and one defensive stand for Fenerbahce to take home this title.
Šeška had one last possession to save its season. Viktor Kriapa was the right man in the right place for a dramatic game-time putback that sent the game to overtime.
Lukas pops a three on the mark. Kostas Lukas jumping in the air. He's got Fenerbahce ahead in overtime. Ando De Colo to Teodosic to Heinz to the basket and in. Kyle Heinz puts Šeška back in front.
De Colo was simply unstoppable, scoring a double digit in overtime without missing a bit from the spot.
If you're a Šeška fan, this is exactly the man you want on that line right now in this situation.
The 101-96 final score made it the highest scoring continental title game in 47 years. CSKA ended years of frustration by lifting its seventh trophy, the second most in EuroLeague history. And after losing his previous six tries at the Final Four, Teodosic was symbolic of the huge sense of relief that enhanced CSKA's celebration.
I didn't know that it's that great feeling winning this trophy. Now I'm gonna work even more hard to get more trophies.
Decolor became the first player ever to sweep the top scorer, season MVP, and Final Four MVP trophies in the same EuroLeague season.
I'm very proud of us because we work hard during all the season. Everybody thinks it's easy because we are CSKA, but we need to fight day by day, game by game, and we did it.
I'm really proud of this team. I'm really proud for those guys that they make first time to the Final Four, to the final, and they reach the goal. They read. This is written now history. I told them that it's written up there, that they have to win that. And they did with a heart, with a soul, with a determination.
It's my first professional championship, so everything is new for me right now. I mean, it just feels unbelievable to do it with these group of guys. It's like a family over here. And I just think we showed that all year, and I think it makes it that much sweeter doing it with these guys.
And after an epic battle, Itoudis could not celebrate his first EuroLeague title as a head coach without giving credit to his mentor.
I hugged Mr. Obradovic and Željko, a great person, a great coach. And I said that a big piece of that is his, although it's a bad moment now because he lost. I wouldn't be over here if he was not him. And that's big, and that's from the bottom of my heart.
In the warm afterglow of their stunning overtime victory in the Turkish Airlines EuroLeague Championship game in Berlin, CSKA Moscow's players and staff had the opportunity to get up close and personal with their new trophy during a private photo shoot before they even left Mercedes-Benz Arena to celebrate. As the newly crowned champions celebrated their triumph and got their hands on the silverware they had just won, emotional coach Dimitris Itoudis revealed that the victory was particularly special for one member of his family.
Definitely this is one of those sweetest ones because my daughter today, actually this morning that comes, she celebrates her birthday, so she asked me that as a present. It was not easy, but I think it's one of the best presents that ever he could have from me, besides my love, my true love.
Karl Heinz, meanwhile, had managed to get hold of extra souvenirs to take home, one of the nets from the championship game.
I seen the net down there, so I went to go cut it. So I mean, like for us, I mean, haven't won it since 2008 as a team. So we're going to take every souvenir that we could possibly take back. We're definitely going to enjoy this back in Moscow. I never had the net before, so I feel like I'm taking this one back with me. I'm going to try to sneak this in my bag and take this one back with me home. Like I said, this is a special, special trophy, a special title, and I want to have this special memory with me.
Showing the team ethic that helped him win the league's Best Defender award, Heinz was delighted to be enjoying these special moments of celebration with his teammates.
To be back on top of the EuroLeague mountain with these great group of guys, I mean, it's an incredible feeling, incredible experience, and I'm really happy to be a part of this team and this great club, especially for guys like Milos, who's been in this Final Four 6-7 times, and for him to get it for his first time, it's incredible. And that's what we fought for. That's why we practice so hard for guys like that, for him to get it the first time. Guys like Demetrius Nichols, who's able to experience this feeling for the first time. That's what we fought for all season, and that's the reason why we feel like we deserve it, and we're so happy to be here.
Andrei Vorontsevich, who was a 20-year-old second-year pro when CSKA last won the EuroLeague title in 2008, could not hold back his affection for the teammates who had accompanied him on the team's journey to glory.
I want to kiss everybody, is like grab them and say congratulations. I want to say, I say already for a lot of guys that congratulations. I want to say for just our fans who watch CSK, who follow the CSK, who just give a part of their energy from us. And I just want to say thank you and congratulations to the CSK to win today, and we are champions.
The youngest player on CSKA's winning team in the championship game was Dmitry Kulagin, who said the experience of getting his hands on his trophy and celebrating with his teammates was allowing his team's success to truly sink in.
Right now, I understand how big it is, how important this in my life. So that's great. That's great, and that's cool. And I hope that that is not my last trophy.
One of the players to stay longest at the photo session with the trophy was team captain Viktor Kryapa, who made sure that he was photographed with as many teammates as possible as he savored a memorable title.
Yes, we'll put them in a wall in the club, in our houses. This is the guys who was the side by side with us in so difficult game, and it's gonna be memory forever. You know, it's coming not only for this time, it's also for the history. It's the history of the Euroleague, of our club, the 7th trophy in our history. So we're pretty excited, and we hope we'll get more chances and more trophies.
Chase, Pero Antic sends up a high pass, and Jan Veselý rises high to the rim to throw down an emphatic one-handed alley-oop slam with feeling. Milos Teodosic is under intense pressure, but somehow escapes it to deliver a pass for Nando De Colo, who scores to give CSKA a three-point lead. Inside the final minute, Fenerbahce completes its astonishing comeback as Bobby Dixon converts a triple to tie the game. During their second quarter fight back, Labo Alcucha's little guys produce a big-time play as Darius Adams delivers a pass with perfect timing for the athletic Mike James to throw it down. With Fenerbahce leading by two, CSKA has one last chance to stay in the game. Nando De Colo can't score, but team captain Viktor Kryapa grabs the rebound and scores to force overtime.